Hello and welcome to the Bendorf Bench, where today a panel of overqualified experts will talk about the Northern Region football playoffs at Division 5 and Division 6. My name is Greg Wyszynski with the Connection Newspapers. Alongside me today, Dan Rubin of the Journal Newspapers, Jeff Graham of the Connection Newspapers, and Pete Bendorf, Director of Student Activities at Madison High School. You're watching the Bendorf Bench, and we'll be right back. People want to kick some ass. Today's show, of course, would be sponsored by our usual gang of wonderful sponsors here on the Bendorf Bench. Ford Quality Care, which, as you know, is conveniently located in Fairfax. It services all makes and models. CCI Screen Printing for all of your screen printing needs. And, of course, House of Pain, where you can put a little tood in your workout. Whenever you want to, really. Well, boys, today I think it's on the docket to talk about Northern Region playoff football. Before we can get there, we have to talk about what happened last week in the Northern Region. Week 10 in the Northern Region, where playoff seeding was set and many surprises occurred. We begin our journey with Centerville defeating the Chantilly Chargers 16-10 in the annual Sully Bowl.
This one happened in overtime, and Centerville gets the win here. Turned out they weren't fighting for a playoff spot, even though they finished at 6-4. I guess overall their forfeit from week one against West Springfield. That turned out that they had to forfeit that game, so they finished at 6-4 and out of the playoffs for the first time in a few years.
Give Centerville a lot of credit too, the way they finished strong. Kind of a rough and tumble season for them, a lot of off-field issues and some tough injuries. They finished real strong with two strong wins to finish the season. Got to give them credit for that. Not packing it in.
I think the other thing is they lost arguably their best player and probably one of the best players very first game of the season in Daniel Bailey. Coach Skinner's played a lot of young guys and they really, you know, they continue to play hard all the way through the season. Chantilly, a senior-dominated team, were in good shape, I think, at week six when they'd beaten Oakton and just ran a tough road in the Concord District.
And we see the Herndon Hornets 26, Oakton 14, knocking a year-old ball club out of the playoff picture there.
Yeah, Herndon really had a good year. Their three losses were, you know, to arguably the best teams in Northern Virginia and Westfields, and they lost to Centerville, which is always a tough game for them, and then Robinson as well. Senior-dominated team in Herndon. Good offensive line, obviously their running game. Oakton's a young team. They really, I think, a 6-4. Coach Thompson did a great job with them. They were competitive all season. Talking to Coach Thompson, he felt like it was the first time his youth really kind of showed up. They made a lot of mistakes, just some situations where they fumbled the ball in key situations. And, you know, Herndon, it was Herndon's turn.
That being said, I asked the panel, did Oakton overachieve this year?
You're asking me?
I'm asking the panel, not necessarily you.
I would say they did. I don't know about overachieve, because it's hard to determine high school football what you got one year to the next. But, I mean, you're talking about a team that lost virtually every starter on defense except one and you know, virtually every key skill player on offense. To come back and be competitive in a district like that, to beat Centerville for the first time, something Pete could probably speak to, maybe not. But that's just really impressive.
For the record, I was
very impressed.
While I was coaching there, we did beat them.
Hey, there you go.
Double overtime.
When I was like,
but
12.
The point being is there's a lot of good football players at Oakton, and the coaching staff that's been there, you know, while I was there, those are great, great guys, and they work real hard at it. And Oakton's going to continue to be a force in Northern Virginia football for a while.
I agree. They found ways to win this year. There's no question about that, especially in week one in that big rivalry game. Checking out the rest of the scores from last week, we see Westfield doing what Westfield does, 56-29 over West Springfield. Westfield cruises to a 10-0 season, enters the playoffs as the number one seed in Division 6.
And last year they finished 10-0 as well, and then they got upset in the first round of the playoffs. So they're still looking for their first playoff win. They're going to be facing off against Herndon on Friday. And West Springville got to be one of your more disappointing stories this year, finishing it at 4-6.
I guess the big news out of this game were some injuries on the Westfield side, right?
Eddie Royal got banged up a little bit, and Evan Royster, their running back, is a little hurt. He didn't practice on Monday, so that'll be an interesting story to see how much they get going on Friday.
I know Royal is definitely a go, he said, on Monday or Tuesday. I don't think it surprises anybody that Westfield's 10-0. I think maybe prior to the season, you thought maybe the Centerville game was a game that I have trouble with. The questions for Westfield will be answered starting this weekend. Going undefeated two straight years, they have to produce in the playoffs this year. Otherwise, I think that'll be a real letdown for them.
I think the interesting thing about West Springfield, just speaking about them for a second, is the fact that they began the season with arguably the best rusher in the northern region, potentially, in Derek Brazil. They end the season with the region's top passer, yardage-wise, in Joey Skeff, who I believe comes back next year, right, underclassmen. So something to look forward to, I guess, in Springfield.
Here's what I'll tell you in my take on West Springfield is they did graduate quite a bit. They had a pretty good two-year run where they had finished 6-4 and not gotten into the playoffs. We had beaten them twice in 01 and 02, and it really was the difference between them getting in and us getting in. So they had a very young defense. To their credit, he retooled us. He had the leading rusher in the region. He retooled his whole offense. 29 points on Westfield is a pretty good job. Obviously, they have some defensive issues. West Springfield always plays a tough schedule, and they lost a lot of close games. Westfield's is a year better. I'm sure that they're. And they beat Herndon 42-7 during the regular season, which is their first round opponent. I don't think you're going to see a repeat of last year.
And we'll of course discuss the playoff games later in the program. Lee 41, Fairfax 7. Lee completes probably their best season in recent memory, at least, winning the Liberty District outright and heading into the playoffs as the third seed in Division 6.
I know, at least since I've been covering up here about 5 or 6 years, Lee's always been a team, especially a few years back, that you kind of We get to about 6-2 or get in playoff contention, and then down the stretch we'd kind of falter. Give them kudos this year for kind of, and the pressure was on them. They had to win out, especially with the Division 6 situation they're in, and they deserve a lot of credit for what they've done.
And Fairfax finishes 4-6 in the Liberty District. They tied Langley overall record and district record, and 4-6.
You got the two Division 6 teams in the Liberty District. They played mostly a Division 5 schedule. Lee has been Coach Pannoni over there, really, he's got 18 seniors, most of whom are three-year starters. This had to be their year. Dan, I think you're exactly right. I got to see him against Madison, and they play with a lot of intensity. They play well as a group, and you can tell that experience. We at Oakton thrived on that last year. I had a lot of guys that had played a lot of varsity football. That's what's paying dividends for Lee. Fairfax, it's going to be a tough year, and I'm sure that they're scratching their head because they're really kind of searching for an identity right now.
And they lost a lot to graduation as well from last year, which at the beginning of the season looked like it might have been a benefit, but I mean, they did lose a lot of talent at their skill positions to graduation. We're going to go to the videotape now. We're going to check out the Marshall Statesmen as they search for their first victory of the season against a team you know a thing or two about, the Madison Warhawks.
Yeah, this is the opening kickoff. And again, I can tell you, this is the Rotary Bowl, and it's a big rivalry. Madison's had the upper hand last 4 or 5 years, and I think out of the last 11 years, they've won 7 out of the 11. So they hit the opening kickoff. This was the next series. Joe Canova going 65 yards or 70 yards, I believe, on a buck sweep. Joe's a junior. He really has pretty good speed, and he's been a nice weapon for Madison all year. Go ahead.
My question is, obviously Marshall is not a playoff caliber team or even one that gives you a test of that. Can that be a problem for you going into the playoffs to have your last game?
Yeah, and I'll talk about that a little bit later. This is just a pass here from Johnny Ayers to Joe Canova. The interception obviously was by Canova as well, who had a heck of a game. And this is Kelly Ginley just on an off-tackle play. Real great effort. Kelly's an outstanding wrestler as well, a regional champion, I believe, at 152 pounds. And here's Johnny Ayers, and we've talked a lot about Johnny on the show. He's just a tremendous athlete. Just a little bit of his athleticism, really, at the game that night, he really took off. It's a great run. He's been playing hurt. Has a broken foot. Doesn't seem to bother him. He's just a tough guy. And here's Kelly Ginley again, putting the final score on the board for a 30-0 win. I'll give Marshall credit. They play hard. They're outmanned. JT Bittison seems to be trying to build that program, and it's not going to be an easy task. We know that. They went 0-10. They were the only school in Northern Region to go 0-10. They showed up, and they played hard, and they played with a lot of class. I was, being an alumni or alumnus, it was good to see that at least. And, of course, Madison rolls into the playoffs at 8-2.
And I think what's deceiving, you see the shutout there. You guys have the third best defense in the region. I think people kind of forget that. We'll all talk about Johnny Ayers, some of the running backs you guys have.
Well, I think it's a couple of things. It's a style of offense that Madison runs. The game is going to be low scoring. The game is, there's not going to be a lot of possessions. So it's, that's, they'll always be in that situation. If they're giving up a lot of points, it's a bad situation.
So Marshall fails to get their first win of the season, but then T.C. Williams goes out and beats what could have been a playoff team Saturday at home.
You got to believe that maybe the Hayfield people looked at the Herndon score the night before and thought maybe that they had no shot to get in. And also you got to give credit to the TC kids, like we said, about teams finishing strong with a lot to play for. I mean, you're talking about a senior class that hadn't gotten a win, and I wouldn't want to calculate the numbers. But that's a good way to finish considering the fact a lot of those guys had never had a varsity W.
I think the other thing is Hayfield really, although they were 6-3 and contention for a playoff, they had really had some things go their way. They had they had lost their quarterback and they were still winning. They were winning ugly, let's say. TC had been competitive, and other than the Robinson game, they had really been in most games. They had an excellent chance and probably should have won the Lake Braddock game. So they'd been close, and obviously Hayfield was, knowing they're out of the playoffs, obviously their kids were a little down, and TC, it was they were ripe for the opportunity.
And for the season, Hayfield's team, as we were calculating the playoff, they'd given up a considerable amount more points than they've scored.
Yeah.
They were the only team in playoff contention that it was even close. Sure. So,
I think to Hayfield's credit, though, I don't think a lot of people before the season thought that game against Robinson in Week 9 would have meant anything,
right,
with what Hayfield was bringing back. To go 6-4 to be that close to the playoffs is a credit to the coaching staff and the kids, I think.
Yeah, 4-2 in the Patriot District again a year is an achievement, that's for sure.
There you go. Moving on, we see that the Langley Saxons won their annual rivalry game against McLean. McLean finishes 1-9, Langley 4-6 under John Howard in his first season. Any thoughts on that game?
I would say this, Coach Howerton approached this season as a learning experience. I think he really didn't go after, obviously he tried to win every time out, but I think he was laying the framework for Langley to be very competitive in the Liberty for years to come. He had to do it his way, and I had some conversations with him about that. He laid the groundwork, the work ethic that he expects, and the energy, and I think Langley will be right back in playoff contention next year. McLean struggled all year. Their one win was against Marshall, and there are probably some changes going on over there as well. I know they're going to get a new AD, a new principal, and some things are going to happen over
there. It's a shame, too, because I used to cover these teams extensively. It used to be really one of the better rivalries in the region, and oftentimes decided a playoff spot a couple times, and it has gotten very lopsided as of late. You can see Langley obviously not having the year that they've been a perennial playoff team for a while, and even a year like this, they're able to kind of win that game pretty easily. So I'd like to see that matchup get a little more contested.
What's in 21, South Lakes nothing. This was a game for a playoff spot in Division 5. I saw this game, and I know that it's not statistically possible, but if there was a way to put a negative number where the zero is, this might be a game to do it. Woodson was in South Lakes backfield all game. Played a tremendous defensive game, completely shut down the Seahawk attack, and really deserved to be in the playoffs this year.
And this was a rematch from the Division 5 championship from a year ago. South Lakes, kind of like Oakton, they lost a lot from last year, and for a team that only won, I think, once in the first month of the season, to finish at 5-5 and have a chance at a playoff spot was pretty good for them. Woodson has given up the least amount of points in the region this year. They finished with a shutout, so they got to be feeling good going into the playoffs.
I don't know how Woodson lost 3 district games. That's my biggest question. It's impressive they turned it around the way they did, but
I think their margin of error is not great because they had sustained some real injuries at quarterback and at tailback. So they were, although they could shut people out or keep them scoreless or keep them within a couple touchdowns, they were having a difficult time scoring. I know that was the situation in the Woodson-Madison game at midseason. Woodson is the team, and we'll talk about that, to watch, because you hear the cliche all the time, defense wins championships. That's how they're getting it done. That's why they are where they are.
I'm shocked to hear that from a former coach. Mount Vernon 37, Wakefield 9. The Majors move on to the Division V playoffs as the number 3 seed. They take on the Madison Warhawks in the first round.
Yeah, and I got to see a little bit of tape of this game. Wakefield was up 9-0, and then Mount Vernon exploded for 37 points. Typical Mount Vernon team. Very athletic at the skill positions. Can score in a hurry. Just in terms of depth and lineman-wise is probably where they struggle a little bit. But they've been pretty good defensively as well. Should be a good matchup.
Yeah, and Mount Vernon's a team that does what it needs to do in the National District. It wins the games it needs to. It lost to Yorktown during the regular season. But 7-3 out of the National is going to get you into the playoffs more often than not.
Well, I guess the classic thing with Mount Vernon is they're usually 0-3 or 1-2 or whatever, and then they win 5 or 6 straight. And
they kind of enter the playoffs under the radar, I think it's fair to say. They haven't been a team that most people have talked about. The other Division V teams have done something to kind of grab the spotlight.
It'd be interesting to see what their September record is, because I'm sure it's over the last 5, 6 years, it's not been very good at all.
Robinson 21, Annandale 7. This actually is the smallest margin of victory for the Rams this season. For whatever that's worth.
I'll tell you two things. The Annandale Robinson game, if you look back over the last couple of years, has always been Coach Adams always has his Adams ready to play. And, you know, that's always a tough game for Robinson. I believe they beat him for homecoming a couple of years ago.
Yep.
You know, Robinson had gone through, and obviously why my brother's not here, a lot of people have been sick and that kind of thing, and they're just nursing a few things. I think they'll be ready to roll this week. But that's just one of those games they play every year, and it's going to be a battle.
Annandale also, they traded punches very well with the three elites.
Yeah, no problem.
Standard elites, the Centervilles, the Westfields, and Robinson really kind of played them probably, if you look at any team that played them the closest or the toughest, I think Annandale will be that team.
All right, well, there's your review of Friday night action and Saturday afternoon action in the Northern Region. Now, we were discussing before regarding the difference between Division V and Division VI football. And now you've gotten to see both worlds in the last year or so. What's the difference?
Well, I will tell you this much, and my experience in Northern Virginia, my original coaching was at Marshall, which obviously was a smaller school in the county. That's where I started. And 1986 is when they started the Division V, Division VI. And Marshall was obviously a Division V school. The first year we had the opportunity to play Division VI, we went and upset TC and Mount Vernon, went into the state playoffs. The next year we played Division V. When it initially started, there was not much difference between the fives and sixes. School size was still pretty large. What's happened over the course of 10, 15 years is there's really been a separation between the two divisions. There's not a whole lot of interplay. There's games here at the beginning of the year, one or two, but those contests they're far, few and far between. I think it's hurt Northern Virginia football. The level of play at Division V and the level of play at Division VI is vastly different in a couple of areas. The squads are much smaller at Division V, and I think that they have gotten to the point where they play a lot of two-way guys. Madison can hold up week after week because they've got good talent, but they're really playing with a small group of guys. It's a relatively small squad, and it works fine in the Liberty District. And I think the interesting thing, and I expect them to play very hard against Robinson, but they haven't played against that competition all year, and it's gonna be a culture shock. I think the classic, and I can always look at it this way. Oakton Madison, first game of season, is always competitive. It always is. By the end of the year, I always felt that we had gotten a lot better, and Madison hadn't progressed as much. And I think it's the level of competition that you play. The game is faster. Because in the third and fourth quarter, the kids are fresher at the Division VI, where in the Division V's, these kids, they're good football players. Certainly, just if they'd been at Robinson or some of these bigger schools, they would do just as well, but they wouldn't be called on to do so many things. I don't think that it's been great. I mean, there's some advantages to Division V and Division VI. You get more teams in the playoffs, keeps teams, involved longer. But it's really you really have this group and this group. There's two separate groups. The level, and I don't think it's helped the programs, the struggling programs. I'm not for, 70-0 games. I'm not for that. But I think because they don't play each other anymore, that's why when they get together, you have some of those.
Interesting insight. No matter what size your school is, big, small, or otherwise, feel free to send us in your information. Stand up and be recognized. You can send it to info@fairfaxsportsnetwork.com. So there you go. Well, I think it's time for us to take a look at the playoffs, Division 5, Division 6, beginning this Friday night at the home fields of four different teams. And we begin our little journey, I think, with the Lee Lancers and the Robinson Rams. Well, this game is, on paper, maybe a little bit of a mismatch. I think there's a certain conception of Lee and a certain conception of Robinson. I think there's no secret. Both teams run the ball very well, though.
I had an opportunity to see both. Robinson's the perennial playoff team. Been in the regional playoff. I can't even tell you how many times, probably 4 out of the last 5 years, I believe, or more. They've won 71 football games in the last 7-8 years. Lee, last time they were in the playoffs, I believe it was 88. But this is the year that they've been building for. They go in with a fair amount of momentum. The question is the level of competition that Robinson's been playing and the level of competition that Lee's been playing. How well Lee adjusts to that and how well they hold up through the game is going to be the big thing. And, does Robinson play to their level? If Robinson plays to their level, I'm certain they'll win. But you that's why you have to play the games, and that's the beauty of the playoffs and not the BCS, which I'm not a fan of.
I would say that also the one thing that would be working Lee's favor, and I don't say this in jest, is if it rains from now until the game time. If you look at a lot of the upsets that have taken place, even there was a week this season when a lot of screwy things happened. Once it gets rain, the ball gets all slippery like that. That can.
It's a great equalizer.
Exactly. So I think that would be the best thing to happen for Lee. I'm not sure they have much control over that. They have to also get off to a good start. Robinson and Westfield, teams like that, you can make the argument. It even happens in basketball with some teams. You make the argument they're up 14-0 when the game starts because the other team can be a little intimidated. If Robinson marches right down the field on them, returns the opening kickoff, I think it could be a real confidence drain on Lee and doesn't bode well for a close game.
I go one step further. I think they need penalties, and I think they need turnovers.
Yeah.
And I don't think if they don't get both of them, they're not going to have a chance in the game. But anyway, we move
on. I buy
that. You buy that for a dollar? Very good.
Less
than a dollar. Fantastic. Mount Vernon is at Madison, and Madison has a beautiful football field. And Mount Vernon's going to play on it. And the Majors have a good defense. And, in fact, I picked them in this game because of that defense to, I guess it'd probably be an upset if they beat Madison this game, right?
These two teams met in the regional championship, Division 5, I believe, 2 years ago. And it was a very close game. Madison was, had the momentum early, a couple turnovers.
Hollywood.
got loose for a big run and turned the game around. And it turned out to be about, I think it was 20-7.
28-6.
Okay, and it was a couple touchdowns,
three
touchdowns,
go.
Whatever. But the point being is I think that, two different contrasting styles. You have both of them are running teams, but they run the ball totally different. Mount Vernon relies on the big play. Madison wants to shorten the game. So that'll be the key, and turnovers is going to be critical.
Just to piggyback on what you said a little bit earlier, Pete, and I think you see this in basketball a lot too. You said about Division 5. I think the Liberty District is still considerably stronger week in, week out than the National District. I think the National District teams suffer going into the playoffs a lot of times because they haven't faced that type. Even the Madison game was a step up. So that'll be an adjustment for them. And Madison is just very consistent. I think they would have, like we talked about earlier, played Oakton very tough in the first week of the season. Probably would have won if the game had been a couple minutes shorter, but they got kind of worn down in the D65 thing. But I think it would be an upset if Mount Vernon wins this game.
Sure. Anyway, we move on. Herndon, Westfield.
Jeff agreed.
Jeff
nodded
Jeff
off
is
camera.
Nodding vigorously that it would be an upset. Yeah. Herndon is playing Westfield at Westfield. And you talk about upsets. This would be an upset, in my opinion, if Herndon was able to win this game. They do have a healthy Brandon Guyer. They are playing good football. They have a ton of momentum after making the playoffs in a Week 10 game. Westfield hasn't had much to play for in the last couple weeks. But, this Westfield team, is there a way to solve this offense?
Well, going back about a month ago, Herndon still remembers that 35-point loss to Westfield when they played them almost a month ago. Coach, going back to last year, you played Westfield a couple weeks before that playoff game, and it was a close match. I believe they took you by a field goal. So when you guys were going into that, you know, that game, you had to know that, you know, you could be able to play with them.
Yeah, I mean, I think the difference there was we had beaten them the year before, and we had a game that we probably should have won. We fumbled with 2 minutes to go, and then they got a field goal to win the game, but it was a very even game. Westfields comes in a year older. Here's the thing, if I'm Tom Meyer over at Herndon, is the only way to slow them down is to control the ball. So you've got to keep the ball away from their offense, and realizing that it's going to take 48 minutes because they can score in bunches quickly. But the longer that you can control the ball against them, the longer you can keep in the game, the mental part of that game shifts. And that's what's got to happen. If Westfield jumps on them early, it could just get ugly. For Herndon, they've got to get to the fourth quarter and be within a touchdown, because at that point, then Westfield's, you know, we haven't won a playoff game. Mm-hmm. We were way better than these guys a couple of weeks ago. What's going on?
And like Dan said before, you know, if it's a, you know, rainy night, last year, you know, in the Oakton-Westfield game, it was very windy. Sean Glennon wasn't, you know, getting a lot of time to pass the ball. Brandon Guyer's a power runner. You know, as we know, he likes to run in between the tackles. He's going to be, you know, the best asset for Herndon this week.
Give Eddie Royal the Dante Hall treatment, too. I think it would be a good move. I'm serious. Kick it out of bounds. There's no point in putting the ball in his hands. He'll kill you.
Hate to shortchange this game, because I think it's going to be terrific, and it's one of the most intriguing matchups of the season. Two great running backs against one great defense. Woodson at Yorktown. What does everybody think?
Well, here's my prediction on the Westfield-Herndon game. It'll be closer than the first time around.
There you go. Woodson, Yorktown, what do you say, Coach?
Most intriguing matchup, I think, of the four. And simply this, and we said this earlier, Woodson plays great defense. Yorktown has been rolling over people. They've got the two-headed running attack there. They've run over everybody. Again, you know, Yorktown's loss was to South Lakes early in the season. I'm sure they're a lot better now, and they're playing with a lot of confidence. The thing I don't know is how good Yorktown's defense is. If they can shut Woodson down, then they'll be fine. They'll score eventually. But, you know, my money goes to Woodson simply because they play great defense.
I say Woodson, you say?
I'll take Woodson.
Woodson?
Irresistible force against a movable object. I'll take the object.
Great wrestling reference. Thank you for watching the Bendorf Bench.
Who did you pick?
I'll pick Woodson.
Okay.
He takes Woodson. Woodson across the board. Thank you for watching the Bendorf Bench. We'll be back next week to cover the games we just talked about.